Hi and welcome.
You're listening to Historic Huguenot Streets Weekly Show on WFNP The Edge, where we discuss New Paltz history and the history of the Hudson Valley. This is, of course, our first show of the new semester, so Happy New Year and welcome back. I'm Caitlin Gallucci, and I'm the Director of Marketing and Communications at Historic Huguenot Street. Since this is our first show in a few months, and for those who may be tuning in for the first time, I'll provide a bit of a recap on what Historic Huguenot Street is, what it does, and why it's important. Historic Huguenot Street is a nonprofit, 10-acre National Historic Landmark District dedicated to preserving historic buildings, artifacts, and manuscripts, and promoting the stories of the Huguenot Street families who founded New Paltz. For those who don't know, New Paltz was founded in 1677 by a group of French Huguenot refugee families who were fleeing religious persecution as Protestants in their native France during the French Wars of Religion. When they first left France, they first settled in a Protestant region of Germany called Defaults, before ultimately coming to North America and what was at the time the Dutch colony of New Netherland. The Dutch were well known for their religious tolerance, and the Huguenot families initially settled in the town of Wiltwijk, which is today's Kingston. But ultimately, they wanted a community of their own. So they arranged the purchase of roughly 40,000 acres of land from the local Munsee Indian tribes and received a land deed confirming it in 1677 from the new English governor of New York, Sir Edmund Andros. And of course, reminiscent of their time in the German region of Defaults, they named their community New Paltz. Huguenot Street in New Paltz is the site of the original settlement. So that land deed was signed in 1677, meaning that this year, 2017, is the 340th anniversary of the original New Paltz deed. It's also the 300th anniversary of our 1717 French church. You can see a reproduction of the French church on Huguenot Street, though the original no longer stands. However, the stones of the original church were actually used to build both the first schoolhouse, which you can see it's marked with a plaque on North Front Street. It's at the storefront, which was until very recently Enchanted Toys. And the stones from the original French church were also utilized to build the foundation of the fall of the next church that was built. And when that church was dismantled, those stones also went to become the foundation of the Reformed Church of New Paltz, which is still on Huguenot Street today. This year, we have a lot of programming planned to celebrate these anniversaries and further explore the earliest days of the area that came to be New Paltz. Tonight, I am joined by Huguenot Street's Director of Public Programming, Kara Gafgen, who can tell us a bit more about that. Hi, Kara.
Hi, Caitlin.
Thank you for being here. So can you tell us a bit about the developments you're making for interpreting early New Paltz that's being presented this year?
Yes, I would love to. I am so excited about everything that we have planned for this year. As you said, we are celebrating 340 years since technically the founding of the town of New Paltz, which is so exciting. But what's most important to note about that is that people were here long before the Huguenots got here and right. New Paltz as a village and town was founded, period. The people that were here prior to European contact were the Munsee Indians. And Munsee being a sub-tribe of the Lenape, which is a word much more recognizable to, I think, people in the area. Mm-hmm. They were here thousands and thousands of years prior to European contact. And right. It's a story almost like the story of the enslaved Africans that has sort of been in the shadows for some time, not just on Huguenot Street by any means. These are underrepresented individuals in all of American history.
Oh, yeah, naturally, yeah.
Absolutely. And that's something that Huguenot Street as an organization has been trying to change. We're trying to pull those stories and that history out of the shadow and bring it to the forefront. And so anyone who's familiar with our organization and the type of programs and events that we do will be familiar with the fact that last year we hosted the Slave Dwelling Project as part of trying to bring the enslaved African story to the forefront. Mm-hmm. This year, we're doing not only a focus on the enslaved Africans, but also doing a big push to interpret more of the history, culture, and sort of life of these Munsee Indians, the people here who were here way before the Huguenots ever got to New Paltz and founded it. And so what we're actually doing this spring is we will be building an authentic Munsee wigwam dwelling on the street. And we are working with Barry Keegan, who has built over 60 of these in his lifetime.
Wow.
He is, yes, I know. Wish I could put that on my resume.
Right.
But he is a museum consultant and an expert in Native American crafts. And he is really so much fun to work with. And so he'll be on site over the course of the month of April, and we'll be opening this dwelling to the general public on our opening day, which will be Saturday, May 6th. So this dwelling is expected to stand for 10 years. And it's going to be incorporated.
Yeah, so this isn't just for this year.
No, not at all.
This is semi-permanent.
Yes, absolutely. Mm-hmm. And so we will be incorporating this into our daily tours and interpretations, which means anyone who comes for a tour to Huguenot Street as of 2017 will get to see and go inside this dwelling. We're also...
That's going to be cool.
It's going to be so cool. I know. Thank you,
I can't wait.
So we're also incorporating it into our school programming. We have different Native American history lessons and activities that we'll be introducing this year for our school-age children and groups that come. It will be incorporated into our special programs and events. So we're hoping to put on presentations, workshops, talks, and things like that, all in relation to Native American heritage, history, and culture, whether that be a canoe hollowing workshop or a cultural dance performance or anything in between is yet to come. But what I can tell you is that while Barry will be building this structure, we will actually be able to offer open sessions for members of the general public and or groups of individuals, so maybe an honor society or a scout group or mm-hmm. any other volunteer organization, maybe a student volunteer organization at the college, to actually sign up for 1 hour at a time sessions to come and participate in the actual construction of this structure. So literally, being a part of our history here and learning not only about the history and culture and lifestyle of the Munsee, but experiencing it yourself. You know, these people, how did they do this? What materials did they use? What tools did they use to build these homes, these dwellings that they lived in? So that's really, really exciting.
Yeah. I would say, I mean, especially for the fact that people in the community will be able to say, I helped build that.
Exactly.
Is really neat.
Exactly. And that's what we're hoping for. We've been sort of consulting, I guess I would say, with a group called the Stockbridge Munsee Tribe. So these are individuals who trace their lineage back to this area in hopes of making this the most authentic and legitimate structure as possible. By no means do I think I can go out to the site and build my own wigwam.
You can't just design this, Kat?
No, I'm not that knowledgeable. I don't have that information or background. So that's another aspect that's been incredibly important to us, is involving these people, that this is a part of their history and their story and their heritage. So that's been incredibly exciting, is getting to know and work and consult with them. And it's been a whirlwind, and I'm so excited to see that this is actually taking place and it's all starting to happen. And one last plug I'll give is that believe it or not, in order to preserve this structure and make it last for 10 years, we're required to have a fire inside of this structure. Wow. And that is because if any moisture were to get to it, the structure could start to get moldy. Mm-hmm. And so to keep it nice and dry, we're expecting that we will have a fire going in the wigwam likely once a week, let's say. So okay. This is also going to be a special opportunity for tour takers because, you know, at a to-be-determined time frame, let's just use like a Saturday afternoon, for example. If you come for a tour on a Saturday afternoon, you will be able to experience, you know, not only going into the wigwam and hearing about that history and culture, but there'll actually be a fire going in it. So that's right. Another really, really cool sort of sensory aspect of the tour experience totally. That it'll we're incorporating.
Smell like a fire. Yep. Feel like a fire.
It is a fire.
Yeah.
A real fire. I know. So that's just a little taste of what we'll be doing even, you know, before opening day. So we've got a lot of exciting stuff coming up.
That's incredibly exciting. I think, so we also have a couple of events coming up, not necessarily about Native American history, but still focusing on some of those earliest days of the settlement, correct?
That's true. And so, as you know, February is Black History Month, which is always a time that we try to enhance and incorporate the, you know, history of Africans and African Americans and sort of, you know, how their lives were on Huguenot Street in New Paltz throughout its history. Mm-hmm. Not to say that we don't do that throughout the year, because we absolutely do. But this is just sort of a time for us where people tend to seek these opportunities and to, you know, show more interest in, you know, hey, it's Black History Month. What's Huguenot Street doing in regards to this topic? So in on February 11th, gosh, I keep forgetting that's already February. So February 11th, we will be having in Dale Hall at 2 o'clock. At 2 o'clock, an awesome talk with historians Eric Roth and Keith Stokes. And that talk is entitled American Irony, Religious Freedom, and Slavery in Colonial New Paltz and Newport, Rhode Island. And so, like early New Paltz, Newport served as a center for religious toleration in colonial North America. Mm-hmm. Yet those who sought religious freedom in these colonies ultimately prospered due to the enslavement of Africans, mm-hmm. hence the American irony.
Right.
So the talk will include an overview of Eric Roth's paper entitled The Society of Negroes Unsettled, The History of Slavery in New Paltz. Eric is absolutely fantastic. He's done numerous talks with us. He formerly worked at Historic Huguenot Street, was the executive director, was the archivist, is a historian. He teaches here at SUNY. He is incredibly knowledgeable and so, so valuable to us. And so he will be there to sort of kick off the lecture and lay the foundation for, you know, how did this take place in New Paltz? How does it directly relate to my town, this area. Mm-hmm. Then Keith Stokes, who's the other presenter, will come in and discuss the tensions between religious, commercial, and government institutions as they debated abolition, freedom, and the years leading up to the American Revolution, and the Newport African community's rapid evolution from enslaved to free. So Keith has served as Rhode Island advisor for the National Trust for Historic Preservation, along with serving on numerous regional and national historic preservation boards. He's incredibly knowledgeable. He is the founding partner and vice president of the 1696 Heritage Group, and we are so looking forward to having him on site and really giving us this comparison, because I think it's important to note that the institution of slavery, it didn't just happen here. We're not just taking our founders and putting the blame on them by any means. This happened in all 13 colonies that became the United States of America. And so how did our town and village compare to other locations, especially in the Northeast? Because, again, for many, slavery tends to actually be a Southern concept. People didn't think it happened in the North.
Right.
So that is going to be incredibly, incredibly interesting. And again, that is on February 11th at 2 o'clock in Dale Hall. Now, the week immediately following that, that would be February 18th, we actually have another talk at 2 o'clock in Dale Hall, and it's going to be another really fantastic one. It's going to be a talk and book signing with historian Vernon Benjamin, who is the author of The History of the Hudson River Valley from Wilderness to the Civil War. Now, Vernon's book chronicles the valley's development from Native American homeland to revolutionary battlefield and beyond. And this is actually a talk that was supposed to take place in January and was rescheduled for this date. But I can tell you I've been trying to get Vernon at Huguenot Street for quite some time
years,
now.
Right?
Yes, exactly. And there always just seemed to be some sort of a scheduling conflict. But gosh, he's really fantastic, and we're excited to have him. So this book was actually published in 2014, and it was apparently 20 years in the making. He actually recently followed up with a publication entitled The History of the Hudson River Valley from the Civil War to Modern Times, and that just came out last year. So another incredible guy. He's lectured on the history of the Hudson Valley at Marist College and Bard since 2003. He will have copies of his book From Wilderness to the Civil War at the talk. So we're very much looking forward to that. So if anyone is interested, you can go to our website and actually pre-register for those. And we actually have a combo ticket. So if you want to go to both, you can actually buy one ticket and save a little bit of money.
Yep. Perfect. It sounds like there's a lot of interesting things already going on this month. We're kind of hitting the ground running.
Always. Even when we're
we're
quote unquote closed. We're not closed.
We're never
don't ever use that term closed at Huguenot Street.
Yeah, you can always call and we'll be there.
Yes.
Great. So right now we're gonna take a quick break. This is WFNP The Edge. Hi, and welcome back. You're listening to Historic Huguenot Street's weekly program on WFNP The Edge. I'm Caitlin Gallucci, and I'm joined tonight by Huguenot Street's Director of Public Programming, Kara Gafkin. So as we mentioned before the break, this year is the 340th anniversary of the Newpaltz Land Deed and the 300th anniversary of the French Church on Huguenot Street. But we also have a national anniversary to celebrate this year, and that is the centennial of the 19th Amendment, granting women the right to vote. And we have some things planned this year to commemorate that anniversary, right, Kara?
We do. It is another very significant year for the women's history as well, like you said. I think what's important to note is it's actually the centennial specifically in 2017 for votes for women in New York State.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
So that's really exciting for us because we have, you know, really focus on these things before some other people do.
So, lucky us.
I know.
So, like, we don't have enough yeah. anniversaries this year.
I know. Literally, when we started scheduling stuff and I was trying to put the 2017 calendar together, I had such a difficult time because I was like, I have too much inspiration.
Yeah.
And it's just, there's so many cool things that we want to focus on and we are focusing on. So it's a very exciting
It's a good
year.
Problem.
It is. It's a fantastic problem. So this year we're actually going to be launching a special women's tour, and it's going to be available as of this March for Women's History Month. And it will be only taking place once a month through to October, likely. So it's going to be very special in terms of, you know, its availability. It will be something that you have to pre-register for. There's going to be limited spaces, and it's going to be incredibly multi-sensory. So what we're doing, and we're actually working with a SUNY Newpaltz intern on this, Allison Surgery.
Oh, that's right. She was on the show last semester.
Yes, she
was. I think she talked a bit about this. Yeah, she's really excited.
Fantastic. She has been with us for multiple semesters. She is a wonderful, wonderful young woman, and she's incredibly passionate about this, which makes it that much more easy to you know, see through to the end and actually, you know, get this done when you have someone who really has their heart in it.
Yeah.
So what Allison has been doing is a ton of background research on women who lived on Huguenot Street or New Paltz, or, I mean, we're going as far as Ulster County, and had an impact on their community, their society, you know, their world. And we're starting at the Wigwam, and Ooh. We're going to be actually talking about one of the women who signed the 1677 land deed. And she was a Native American woman. And sort of, you know, why did that happen? Why was there a Native American woman who signed the land deed, but none of the Huguenot women did? So right. The differences and sort of the rights and things like that.
Different cultures.
Yes, exactly.
It's fascinating.
Exactly. And what's going to be really unique about this tour is it will be a guided tour. However, we're incorporating technology and a little bit of theater arts into it. So what we'll be doing is we'll actually be taking a little bit of creative liberties and using all of Allie's research, and we're going to be writing monologues for each of the specific women that we talk about on this tour.
Oh, wow.
And so we'll be recording those monologues, and we'll be either playing them on an iPad that the guide carries on the tour, or we will be having SUNY New Paltz Theater Arts students actually acting out these monologues as these women in the historic houses. So we're really looking forward to launching
that.
It's going to be a lot of fun. And then for our Women's History Month event, we will be having a concert in the French Church, which, as you said, turned 300 years old this year.
Oh, I didn't even realize that. Wow.
Yeah. So that concert will be on Saturday, March 11th, and it will begin at 4 o'clock. And it is with balladeer Linda Russell, who is also returning to Huguenot Street. We've done a handful of programs with her in the past. She is so incredibly talented. And this year, or I should say, in the month of March, she will be performing A History of American Women in Song. So this will it will illuminate the role of women's lives in society from the 18th century to the 19th Amendment. She's going to be singing everything from love songs to murder ballads to suffrage anthems that reflect the changing status of women in society. So she is just, like I said, incredibly talented, and we're really excited to have her back. In fact, she has 8 albums recorded.
Oh, wow.
I know.
You know what? I guess I'm not that surprised.
I know.
I mean, you know what? Yeah, that makes sense now that I think about having seen her before.
Yeah, so she will, that registration is actually also open. So if anyone out there is interested in getting those tickets before they're sold out. Yes, save the date, exactly. And last but not least, what I will plug before the end of the show here is the return of our very popular, oversold out family program that we launched last year, and that is our Tea Time event, which we did last year with author of some of the American Girl doll books, Valerie Tripp.
That was so exciting.
It was absolutely fantastic. Like I said, we oversold out, and that's why we're bringing it back, as it just had such an impact on the people who attended, and it was really fantastic. So that will be taking place Saturday, April 22nd this year, and we're actually going to be hosting it with one of our staff members, our school programming coordinator, Jennifer Bruntel, who is a 12th generation Huguenot descendant, and is just about to publish her children's book entitled Hugo the Huguenot, and it's all about the founding of New Paltz.
Yeah.
So
I think it's cool to mention that Jennifer really did this of her own accord. Like, Huguenot Street did not ask her to write a book about the Huguenots.
That is correct.
As a 12th generation descendant, she is so passionate about this, which is why it's so great that we have her as a school programming coordinator. She was independently inspired to do this, and now, you know, it's just so exciting that we get to be a part of it.
It is, and she, you know, like everyone else we have at Huguenot Street, is so incredibly awesome and talented. So her books will be there. She'll be reading from her book. There will be crafts. We will be raffling off another American Girl doll, just like we did last year. This year, our theme is, of course, the Muncie girls. And so we will be raffling off Kaya, which is the Native American American Girl doll. Our guests will be able to actually write their own Muncie girl story and enter a contest to win a prize. So another awesome event that, you know, get your tickets now because it sold out last year.
Yeah. No, and quickly, I think.
Yes.
No, that's awesome. So excited for that book. That's one of the great things is that, so we've spoken about four events tonight, and they are all already available to pre-order tickets on our website at HuguenotStreet.org. So we're wrapping up now, but listeners can tune in every Thursday at 7:30 p.m. for the rest of the semester at WFNP.org or 88.7 FM to hear more from Historic Huguenot Street. And check out HuguenotStreet.org for information on these events that we spoke about and all the rest of the events we have coming up this year. You can also follow us on social media and sign up for our email list to stay informed on what's happening on the street. Thanks for listening.